35. And there are great promises in this chapter concerning the gospel, concerning the going forth of the gospel to the nations, and then ultimately the blessing of the eternal kingdom. Isaiah 35, the wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given unto it, the excellency of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God. And in verse 10, the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. And while these words do have a great fulfillment when we reach Zion above, they also have a present fulfillment. That we are the ransomed of the Lord. We have been brought into that universal body, His church. We are then to come with songs, with everlasting joy. And may there be gladness today in the hearts of the Lord's people as we worship our great God. We will seek the Lord's face together briefly in prayer. Our gracious Father, we thank Thee for the gospel. We thank Thee, Lord, for a people that have been ransomed through the redemptive work of our Lord Jesus Christ. The price for our redemption has been paid. And therefore today we do rejoice. Oh Lord, we pray that in this season that our complaints, our groanings will be set aside, as it were, and in this time that we will be taken up with the majesty, the greatness of our God, and the wonder of His redemption. Grant help then, we pray, in our Lord's name. Amen. Going to turn in our hymn books to the hymn 42, the third section in the hymn book. It's on the page 192. So page 192, the hymn 42, O God, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder, then sings my soul. And we'll stand together as we sing.
I see the sun. workspace together.
Our gracious Father, we rejoice as we approach thy holy presence, that we come before a great God, the God whose majesty and power is demonstrated to us in creation. How great is our God? And yet, wonder of all wonders, thy great mercy is demonstrated to us in the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. The Father did not spare the Son, gave him up for us all. And, O Lord, we thank thee that Christ did not hold back himself. He gave himself for us. He gave himself as an offering for sin. We stand amazed that the sinless one, out of great love to unworthy, rebellious creatures, gave himself as that sacrifice. What we have heard is an eternity separated from thee. We thank thee for the mercy of God and the gospel, that it is offered to all that believe. Thank thee for each believer in the meeting, and those to whom the gifts of repentance and faith have been given. We rejoice, O Lord, that we can testify that all the way in our Christian journey, the Lord has led, guided, and guarded. How great is our God. O Lord, we pray for those in our company today that are still outside of Christ, those who are still lost. O Lord, we cry to thee that today blinded eyes will be opened. We cry to thee today that the unconverted will be awakened to their need. Then we pray that they will be directed to the atoning work of our Savior. We pray that there will be those today that run as it were to the city of refuge, that those that there will be those that enter the ark of God's salvation. Mercy upon the lost, we pray. Lord, we thank thee for these holiday weeks. We pray, Lord, that our children, young people, will know refreshment before returning to their study for another year. And, O Lord, we pray that they will be blessed in this year before us in the will of God. Most of all, we pray that each one of them will be truly converted and truly walking in the ways of the Lord. Spare them, we pray, from this wicked world and its philosophies. And we recognize the devil is out to destroy them. We pray for thy preserving hand to be upon the youth of this flock, God. Oh Lord, we pray for every individual and family connected with this congregation. We pray, oh Lord, that this year will be one of proving our God. O Lord, we cry to thee that the windows of heaven will be opened. O Lord, we pray that thou wilt pour out a blessing, that there is not room enough to receive. O Lord, do for us, as our motto text says, that thing that is far exceeding abundant above all that we can ask or think. O Lord, we cry to thee for the salvation of lost souls. We cry to thee for evident growth and grace in the lives of thy people, for new doors of service to open to individuals in this nation. Lord, that there will indeed be a moving forward. We pray for every faithful witness across. Very especially remember our own sister congregations. Bless them, we pray. May this 2 year of increase for them. O Lord, prosper thy cause, we pray. And O Lord, we pray that in this year that our Lord's name will be honored in the preaching of the gospel of peace. And so do us good in this time. We all will said and done, sung and read, will be honored and glory, that man will be forgotten, that he is where far behind the cross. Today Christ then is preeminent and exalted. Forgive us of our sins, we pray. We're going to turn again in our hymn books to the Psalm section at the beginning of the hymn book, and this is Psalm 25. Psalm 25, to thee I lift my soul. I trust in thee, my God, let me not be ashamed, nor foes exalt your name. Psalm 25 is the first version, page 21, and we're singing to the end of the verse 5, ending with the words expecting to 10. We're using a different tune than we normally use, but I trust you'll recognize the tune and sing out to the best.
Journey back towards home. His hard for us to imagine the anguish that they felt as they realized they've traveled a whole day from this massive city of Jerusalem, where people came from all around the world at that time of year, and they don't know where the Lord Jesus is. So they travel back, and for the next 2 solid days, they search through the city, trying to find their son. It's hard to imagine the anguish. You would have to be a parent or a grandparent to understand the grief that they felt. So much so that when our Lord's mother found him, she said to him, "We have sought for you sorrowing." In other words, we feared the worst. After 3 days, they didn't expect to find him, or perhaps to find him alive. And yet, for those whole 3 days, pardon me, the Lord Jesus was not lost for a moment. He knew exactly where he was. He went straight to the temple when they went for the worship of the Passover, and he stayed there. And for while they traveled away, he stayed on there for another 3 days. We remember that Joseph was not the Lord Jesus' father. And so for the Lord Jesus, as he went to the temple, he was in his father's house. There was nowhere closer to home, you could say. His parents didn't have to say to him, "The young lad, you need to be in church this Sunday." It's where he wanted to be. And so for those 3 days, he was content to stay in his father's house. And as he did, he sat with the leaders of the land, the leaders and teachers and scribes, and he discussed the word of God as a 12-year-old. It was his delight. He was the author of it. Nothing would please him more than to talk about the very words that he had inspired through his Holy Spirit. As we think of our Lord there in the temple, we think of him as a boy, 12 years old, and yet he is able to discuss the Word of God with the very greatest minds of the day. And not only that, he is able to discuss it with authority. It says that the scribes were amazed as they discussed doctrine with him. Because whilst they would come to a passage of scripture and say, "I wonder if it means this, or perhaps it meant that," the Lord Jesus, this 12-year-old boy, would say to them exactly what it meant. He knew. You remember the Jews asked him when he talked about Abraham. He says, "You're not even 50 years old, but you've seen Abraham?" He says, "Before Abraham was, I am." The Lord Jesus, as a 12-year-old boy, would have looked like any other boy, but he is the eternal Son of God. He is one of the Godhead, of the triune God. He is subject and inferior to nobody in heaven or in earth. Yet when his mother comes to him there in the temple, and I'll paraphrase, she says to him, "How could you do this to us? Didn't you know that we would be anxious, that we would be searching for you? How could you cause us this anguish and stress? We have sought for you sorrowing." The next verse is an amazing verse. He says to them, "How is it that he sought me? Wist he, or did he not know that I must be about my father's business?" Then it says, "And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject unto them." He was subject unto them. Young people, I'd like you to see that this is the very Son of God. Yes, he may be 12 years old, having been born of the Virgin by the Holy Spirit, but he is the eternal Son of God. When his mother comes and scolds him, not for any sin, for he was without sin, but she scolds him nonetheless. "How could you do this to us?" He doesn't answer her back. He doesn't become defensive. It says he went back with them to Nazareth and was subject to them. That word "subject" means to be submitted. It actually comes from a Greek word meaning to be beneath or to be under. In other words, you're under authority. It means to be, you submit yourself to that authority. There are two forms of being subject. The one is that you are forced into subjection. You're beaten every day, a until you conform and do as you are told. You remember the children of Israel when they were slaves in Egypt. They were forced into subjection. And that is not the subjection that it says our Lord Jesus subjected himself to his parents. We remember Joseph. We talked about Joseph before. His was a willing subjection. He willingly submitted to Jacob, his father, when he sent him to go find his brothers. And this is the kind of subjection that it says of our Lord. He willingly, imagine, the second person of the Godhead willingly subjects himself to his mom and dad. In this, our Lord Jesus is our example. You and I are to follow his example and be subject to every authority. Romans chapter 13, verse 1, it says, let us be subject to every higher power. It means every position of authority. And verse 5 goes on to say, you must needs be subject. This is what you need to do. You need to submit yourself to your parents as God's first part of authority over you, to your teachers, to our civil and church governments, to the police, to the government of the nation. But all of these authorities are under one great authority, and that is the Word of God. God has told each of those authorities how they are to govern as the higher powers, according to the Word of God. We are to live in submission, subjection to that. I say this to you because we live in a day and age where the culture is not like this. It does not subject itself. It does not submit. Rather, you will be taught from a very young age to challenge every authority. I was shocked when I arrived in this country and heard our people speak to the police and to the teachers. It's not how we spoke to them in Zimbabwe, I can assure you, for we suffered the consequences. But that is the culture you are being raised in. It is to push against every authority. And especially, it is to push against the Word of God as God's ultimate authority. Our Lord Jesus is our example in this, how he subjected himself firstly to his parents. I would like you to try and think that even as he did that, he knew more than his mom and dad. He is the eternal Son of God, but he subjected himself to them because God had appointed them as his mother and father for that. He didn't always agree with them. The Roman Catholic Church will tell us that Mary was perfect and without sin. Well, that's not true. Our Lord Jesus came to save her from her sin as much as you and I. His parents made mistakes. Well, they lost him. No doubt they had times of arguing. But he subjected himself to them because they were the mom and dad that God had given him to grow up under. Young people, you will know if you are living with this kind of subject, submissive heart or not. Not just from what you say, but from your tone of voice when you answer back. Beware, because if you answer back harshly to your mom and dad, you might think, it's just my mom. It's just my dad. They also don't know everything you know. But the Word of God says that when you do that, you are resisting, you are challenging the authority of God, because he has placed them in that position of authority. Before I conclude, let me say this. If I was to just say to you, you must follow Jesus' example, or else you will be punished. Well, that would be a very harsh thing to say to you, because I would have to look at my life of 50-something years and say, well, I didn't do it. I didn't always subject to my mom and dad. In fact, that's how I was brought to repentance, by seeing it, the way I treated my mother. But the Lord Jesus did not just come as our example. He came as your Savior. He obeyed his mom and his dad perfectly. He subjected himself to every governing authority for you and I, so that when you come to believe in him, he takes your sin, he takes your rebellion, he takes your answering back and your pride upon himself, and he gives to you his perfect obedience, his perfect subjection. Oh, it is a joy when you obey the Lord Jesus Not because you're being beaten for it, but because you love him and you desire to please him. Our loving and our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your dear Son, our Lord and our Savior. We thank you above all, Lord, for his atonement. Lord, I pray for each young person here today. Lord, if they are honest before you, they will acknowledge that they have a submissive heart that we see in our Lord Jesus. They have need to confess and repent. I pray for each one that you would save them, that you would draw them savingly to your dear Son. Pray, Lord, that you would give them that meek and teachable spirit, especially at the sound of your word. May their hearts be inclined, Lord, not just to hear it, but to obey it. I pray for each one, Lord, that they would know the joy of an obedient, submitted life. Oh, Lord, not the grief, not the anger and the anguish of a rebellious life. Draw them to your dear Son, we pray, not only as their great example, but as their Lord and their Savior. This is our prayer in Jesus' name.
We will turn our hymn book, please, to the hymn 219. Matthew Betts for bringing that message for the boys and girls. And it's all a beautiful example in Christ there, as well as seeing his provision for us. 219, a ruler once came to Jesus by night to ask him the way of salvation and life. The master made answer in words true and plain, he must be born again. 219, as we sing these words, the offering for God's work will be received. If you didn't come prepared for an offering, please just let the bag pass by. So 219, remaining seated.
Thank you.
We will turn, please, in God's Word, first of all, to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3, and then we'll come to Romans chapter 8. Genesis chapter 3. And we will read, please, from the verse 15. Genesis chapter 3, reading from verse 15. The Lord here addresses Satan. I will put my enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children. Thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it, cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also of thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. And unto Adam, and Adam called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living. Unto Adam also, and to his wife, did the Lord God make coats of skins, and clothed them. The Lord God said, behold, man is become as one of us, to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand, and take also from the tree of life, and eat and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the garden of Eden, till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man. He placed at the east of the garden of Eden cherubim and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. And then we'll turn to Romans chapter 8, continuing our studies in this book. Romans chapter 8 and the verse 18. Romans 8 and the verse 18. Paul says, for I reckon, calculate, that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature, or the creation, was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who had subjected the same in hope. Because the creature, the creation itself, also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. We know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. Not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves, groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, or that is, the redemption of our body. And we'll end there, knowing the Lord will add his blessing to the reading of his precious truth. We're going to seek the Lord's face together, please, in prayer again, asking the Lord for his help as we come and meditate upon his truth. Our gracious Father, we confess how much we do need thy help. We cry to thee that the scriptures of truth will come fresh authority to our hearts this day. Write thy word, we pray, upon our hearts. To that end, give that needed help of the Holy Spirit of God. I need thy help. Every hearer needs thy help. So we pray that the word will come, freshness, power to every soul.
In our Lord's name we
pray.
Amen. Amen.
Back when I was in Bible college, one of the students one day commented that he always seemed to be preaching messages of encouragement to the Lord's people. The reply that he was given was, well, surely the Lord is leading you to preach those messages because that is exactly what the people need. God's people need encouragement. Now, we need more than encouragement, but we do need encouragement. In this latter part of Romans chapter 8, Paul brings words of great encouragement to the Lord's people. John Murray pointed out that the latter part of Romans 8 really has three main points of encouragement. Firstly, this disproportion between the sufferings that we have in this life and the great glory that lies before the people of God. Then, secondly, the Holy Spirit ministering to us in our infirmity, sustaining us in our infirmity. Then, thirdly, that all things are working for our good. And today, I want to come back to this matter of the disproportion between our present suffering and future glory. I mentioned this at the end of the message last Lord's Day. And Paul takes this thought then of verse 18, and he expands upon it in the verses then that we want to look upon this morning. Now, last week, as I mentioned this, I spoke of how, as individual Christians, we are to make a calculation. Each one of us, as Christians, are to do some accountancy work. And so we are to calculate, as it were, the sum of our present suffering. But then we are to calculate the sum of that future glory. And we will see that the two columns can never balance, that our future glory far outweighs any and all of our present suffering. And yet, that is not all that Paul is actually saying here. What Paul is saying here is something greater. Paul is actually saying that not only do we make this calculation as individual Christians, but we are to calculate all of the suffering of all of God's people in this age. And as we calculate that, as we get that sum, that even that, so small in comparison with that glory that shall be revealed in us, I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. As you think of that sum total of all of the suffering of God's people through the age, and then you think of your own, well, yours is so small in comparison with the total. Paul is really saying we need to get a correct perspective on this whole subject of suffering. And again, he's not undermining our suffering, but he is saying that even for the child of God in the most intense suffering, whatever form that takes, we're to have this proper perspective. Now, but then Paul looks at it from a different angle, and he says that we as God's people share something with creation. Now, he is emphasizing that this is not true, this comparison is not true of the unconverted. It's only true of those that have the first fruits of the Spirit, those that have the Holy Spirit in them. But those that have the Holy Spirit in them share something with creation. And in the Authorized Version, we have in this passage the word creature and the word creation. Now, I feel, along with many others, that the words should both be translated as creation. It's actually the same word, a creature and creation. Of course, creatures are part of the Lord's creation. Paul's argument here really is this. Creation is waiting for the coming again of Jesus Christ. So are those that have the Holy Spirit. When Christ does come, creation will be delivered from its present struggles. And so too will those who have the Holy Spirit in them. And so here's this parallel. Creation is waiting. Wait. Deliverance is coming for creation and the Lord's people. And therefore, the creation of this passage is personified, personality. It is ascribed to creation. This is not unique to this passage. Earlier, we read from Isaiah chapter 35, where it speaks of gladness in association with creation. And so through the Word of God, we read of creation laughing, creation clapping, creation rejoicing. And here, we read of creation groaning, creation yearning. And it yearns then, as I've said, along with the people of God. God's people, the true believers, are in harmony with creation. That's what we want to consider then, together with the help of God, creation and the Christian in harmony. I want to see, first of all, with you, that the fall is our common complaint. The fall is our common complaint. Both creation and the Lord's people have this common lament. And it's the lament over the entrance of sin as well as the persistence of sin in the world. And both creation and the Christian identify that the cause of suffering in the world is the fall. And so as this question is so often asked, how can a loving God allow suffering in the world? Both creation itself and the Christian know the answer. So many of the unconverted will reject this and they wrestle with this question, but God's people identify. There is suffering in the world because of the sin of Adam and because of the persistence of sin in the world. Therefore, we're under this common plight, a world that is under the curse. If you look with me at verse 20, for the creature, I'm going to read it then, creation, for the creation was made subject to vanity. And the word vanity there has the idea of futility or not fulfilling its original purpose. So God created creation good. Until the fall, creation was perfect. But after the fall, the creation was made subject to vanity, not willingly. That is, creation was not asking God, please curse us. It's not willingly. It's not the fault of creation. Then by reason of him who is subjected to same in hope, and I believe what the latter part of verse 20 is saying is that God placed the curse upon creation knowing one day it would be removed. And therefore, it was subjected to this curse. Creation would groan, but God subjected it to it in hope that it would not be forever and ever. This word, going back to the word vanity, subject to vanity, it also is the idea of deterioration, dissolution. Remember, Paul is speaking on this subject of suffering. And he is reminding us of the reason why there is suffering in the world. And he is saying we need to get this correct perspective on suffering. And he says we need to recognize the world is in a state of deterioration. And what Paul is speaking of here is perfectly in keeping with what we observe in the world around us. But it is completely contrary to the theory of evolution. The theory of evolution is built on the premise that things are improving, that things are getting better, that chaos has given way to great complexity and continual improvement, and therefore we are to expect that the world is a better place. The problem, of course, with that is that it is not what we observe. Things are getting worse. And even in the examples that evolutionists give us, they do not prove evolution, but they are perfectly in keeping with what Paul is describing to us here. And so, for example, the evolutionists will give examples of greater speciality, breeds, narrowing characteristics. But what does that involve? It involves the loss of genetic information. And so the tighter a breed becomes, there is more loss of genetic information. This is what Paul is describing. Creation has been subject to vanity, deterioration. It's come about a kind of man-sin, about a kind of fall. And we are to recognize that not only does creation suffer because of Adam, and it is chiefly so because of Adam's sin, but creation also suffers because of our sin. That's something we don't think about so often today. Remember in Deuteronomy 28, verse 23, in that chapter, there are curses and blessings. If you're obedient, this is what will happen. If you're disobedient, this is what will happen. And in the curses section, so the consequence of disobedience, the heaven that is over thy head shall be brass, the earth that is under thee shall be iron. That is, if God's people in the Old Testament would persist in their disobedience, that would be the cause of drought and famine. Their sin would add to suffering. Or you remember that time when Achan stole those goods from Jericho, he hid them under his tent, early in the book of Joshua. Remember how he was to be put to death for his sin. Joshua 7:24, he would have his oxen, his donkeys, his sheep. They were also swallowed up by the earth. They suffered on account of the sin. Calvin, going back to the sin that Adam and the suffering that Adam's sin has brought upon creation, Calvin said all creation was made for man's good. And so when we read the creation account, it is all pointing to the sixth day of the creation of man. God created the place for man to live. God created the plants. God created the sun and the moon for us to be able to live on earth. God created the animals. It was all for man. So Calvin said, all creation is made for man's good, and the suffering of creation shows God's displeasure with man. So the suffering of creation is because of man, not because of creation itself. The creation was made subject to vanity, not willingly. Now, coming back to what Paul is saying here about the groves. We identify that creation is suffering, that there is this deterioration. Creation is not fulfilling its original purpose. And so if you like gardening, that's why you have to go to Bunnings to get fertilizers. That's why you have to buy different chemicals to kill off the pests. Creation is suffering. It's not a perfect world. We see even around us, don't we, those places where plants that are native to this place, they are allowed to grow. Some certainly grow well, but you walk through the bush, what do you see? You see death. You see decay. Certainly not all perfectly good. And so creation is lamenting. And Paul is saying, we lament with it. Creation has this sorrow. It's groaning. And so too do we then, while we're on earth. And so, yes, all of mankind is suffering. But our groanings are distinct in that we recognize that the cause of our suffering is sin. Now, it's not always my own particular sin or your own particular sin. Sometimes it is. But all of our suffering is because we live in a world that's under fall. We need grace then, don't we? As we think of creation, it's not fulfilling perfectly its original function. It was created perfectly. It was created to the glory of God. It's not able to perfectly fulfill its purpose, nor are we. And this is part of our lamentation, that we are not perfectly glorifying our God. And in our groanings in the present time, then it's our yearning. Lord, enable me, even in all of this suffering, to glorify God. And so when you go out to feed your plants or water your garden, or when you take those dead plants and throw them in the green bin or in your composting pile, remember this, that as there's the evidence in the plant world, in the created world, of deterioration, it reminds you that you need grace. You need the fertilizer everywhere. You need nourishment. You need nurturing. Dear Christian, then every day we recognize this world is not our home. But we need God's grace to glorify our Creator, yet Redeemer. The fall is our common complaint. But then I want to see, secondly, the consummation is our common hope. And by the consummation, I mean our Lord's coming again. The coming again of Jesus Christ is the hope of creation, that it will be delivered from this decay and disease. That's the hope of God's people. And so if you look with me at verse 19, it says, for the earnest expectation of the creature, the creation, waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. The manifestation of the sons of God. And that word manifestation has to do with revelation. It's the same word that's spoken or used at the end of verse 18. Revealed in us. There's a future revelation. Now remember, in this chapter, Paul has been talking about the Holy Spirit witnessing to our spirit, that is to the true believer, that God. If you go out to the world and you say to them, I am one of the Lord's, and those that are not converted, they will be lost. I am the Lord's, because the Holy Spirit, through the word, is testifying to my spirit that I am a child of God. The world will look at you as if you're crazy. And they will certainly reject your testimony. Paul is saying, in the present time, there is a revelation to us. The Holy Spirit is revealing himself to us and testifying to us through the word. But when our Lord comes again, there will be a revelation about us. That is, when the Lord comes again, the Lord will declare to the ungodly. Those people were right. They are my people. They were saved by grace. The Holy Spirit was testifying to them. And so this is then the manifestation. Sons of God now. But it will be manifested to all when our Lord comes again. So this is the first aspect. Then Paul speaks in verse 21 of liberty, deliverance, because the creature, the creation itself also shall be delivered or liberated from the bondage of corruption into the glorious of the children of God. And so there's a deliverance, a liberty coming up for creation. Creation will be delivered from that curse that God placed upon it in Genesis chapter 3. Creation itself shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. We are going to be set free. And Paul then goes on to describe what this freedom for us is. Verse 23. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption. Now we are not waiting, as I've said, to become the sons of God. What is this adoption then that he's speaking of here? Waiting for adoption. That is the redemption of our body. So Paul is saying, for the Christian, our souls have been redeemed. Our souls have been set free, but not our bodies. We still sin. We still have sinful thoughts. We do sinful things. Going back to Romans 7, there is this great struggle. But when the Lord comes again, the struggle is over. There will be the redemption of our body. That's why this body has to die. And we need a reconstituted body. We need a new body, a perfected body that knows nothing about this present firmly. And therefore, John Murray spoke of how redemption not only delivers us from sin, condemnation of sin. Christ's redemption delivers us from all consequences of sin. The redemption then of the body is coming. This is all one day. Our Lord comes again. He declares, these are my people. He reveals the church, the bride is his. There will be this liberty. There will be these new bodies for the people of God. And therefore, we are to get a right perspective about the subject of the earth. On this subject of creation, I was interested in reading the words of Thomas Boston, where he spoke about this passage, and he related it to the subject of cockfighting. And he's saying in his day that Christians should be very clear that God's people should have no part in it. We should not abuse creation. And yet, while we're to care for the creation God gives, our hope is not in being environmentally minded. The deliverance that Paul speaks of here, this liberty, is not through environmentalism. It's through our Lord's coming again. The consummations are coming. Then I want to see, thirdly, this really is the burden of the passage, that waiting is our common activity. Verse 19 says, for the earnest expectation. The earnest expectation. It's two words in English, but one word in Greek. And it really has the idea of raising. raising the head and thrusting it forward. And so it could be used, for example, of a watchman. He's watching to see the messenger coming. And so he's keeping his head forward to see. He's expectant. So, there's this earnest expectation. And then Paul uses the word groaning. And I'm told this word groaning can be used of a time when someone would be carrying a burden. And the burden, the thing in their back, is really pushing down on them so much so that they're even struggling to breathe properly. And they're just yearning to get this load off. And longing to be shed of it. And then he uses the word travail in verse 23, the language of childbirth. It's a great struggle. There's anguish. There's pain. Now, we can't look at any of that language and say that God's people are waiting indifferently. We can't take any of that language of Paul and say that Paul doesn't really care whether you're thinking about the Lord's return or not. When a lady is in the delivery suite, she's not thinking about the cleaning. She's not thinking about the shopping. She's not thinking about something she read in the newspaper yesterday. She is longing that this child would be delivered and it would be in her arms. And dear Christian, there are many things to take our attention. And we have to give some attention to them. And yet, in a sense, we're to be like that lady in the delivery suite. Our real focus is to be this, Lord, I'm longing for the day when all of this struggle is over. I'm longing for that day when the Lord comes again, I will appear in glory in a new body. And so if you look with me in 2 Peter chapter 3, 2 Peter chapter 3, and I believe this passage has such an impact on the whole discussion of our Lord's coming again. 2 Peter 3 in verse 10, the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, unexpectedly, in which the heavens shall pass away with great noise, the elements shall melt with fervent heat, the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved. As you see, this present creation will be burned up, destroyed by fire. We see then what manner of persons, what people we ought to be in all holy conversation, all holy conduct, behavior, and godliness. Looking forward. That's waiting, tasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, the elements shall melt with fervent heat. And now remember, creation is longing for this day. Why is creation longing that we would be burned up? That is, the creation would be burned up. Because verse 13, we look for new heavens and new earth. Creation is longing for that deliverance that I spoke of earlier, through this renewing. As Peter and Paul are in agreement, we are waiting. We are longing for our Lord's again. We are longing for that great restitution of all things, as Paul and Peter described in Acts. Back to verse 18 in Romans 8. I reckon that we are not living in that day when our Lord comes again. We're yearning for it. But we have to live in the present time. This future day impacts greatly upon how I as a Christian live today? That I remember that everything around me is temporary, but I place my focus on that which is eternal. That my purpose is not to build a great palace for myself. Rather, everything is to point forward to that which is future. That's why Paul uses this word, first fruits of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is in us, but the first fruits was the guarantee of the rest of the harvest and the fall. It's yet to be. As we come to a close, I've emphasized that this comparison is only true of those that are converted. The comparison is not true of the unsaved. The unsaved are not yearning for the day when the Lord comes again. How can they? The unsaved should be living in terror concerning that day. The earth will be burned up. It will be a great renewal. New earth. What will it be for the ungodly? Cast into everlasting fire. Oh, dear unsaved one, this passage exhorts you then to come to Christ. Time you were in him. It's time that you knew the reality that the Holy Spirit is in you. The Lord Jesus then said, come unto me. Today, if you hear his heart, harden not your hearts. Come to Christ for mercy. You remember on Calvary's cross, it was as if all creation reacted to what was taking place. There was the earthquake, the opening of graves, the darkness. All creation was testifying to the greatness of that hour. It's as if all creation is saying to you, sinner, how can you ignore what Christ did on that cross for the sinner? You need forgiveness and cleansing through that word of Christ. Come then to him today for mercy. May the Lord take his word and bless it to your hands. Divide together, please, in prayer. If there is one today, and your testimony is not, I'm yearning for our Lord's coming again, and the reason being, you're not in Christ. Today, in the closing moments of this meeting, plead to the Lord for mercy. He is ready. He's willing to see. May you come to him. Our gracious Father, we thank thee for thy word. Oh Lord, we thank thee for all the instruction that it gives us. Seal it to our hearts today, we pray. Oh Lord, we pray that this yearning every believer will be increased. Oh Lord, we pray that we will be enabled to live in this present time unto our Lord's honor and glory, looking forward and hastening on to the coming again of our great Savior. Draw the lost to thyself, we pray. Bless us in our time of fellowship. We thank thee for refreshments, bless them to us, and later take everyone to the various places in safety. Abide with us through this thy day. Again, we ask for thy help this afternoon. Be unto him that is able to keep you from falling, to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, in glory and majesty, dominion and power, now and ever.